Okay, now just a quick short run about arthritis. I'll be just discussing some salient points because arthritis in itself is a huge topic. So just how to approach an x-ray when you get a knee x-ray of arthritis particularly. So the radiograph that you take in a knee arthritis is AP view. Obviously, that's the most common view. Standing or supine. Standing or a weight bearing has more importance in arthritis because you can actually judge the joint space narrowing when the patient is standing. Lateral view, skyline view is not always taken, but if you want to see the patellofemoral compartment, that's when you can see. Rosenberg view. Now, this is a weight bearing or a standing radiograph, which is done with 40 degree flexion of the knee. And this is particularly important to diagnose early OA because you can see the joint space very nicely. So even mild narrowing in the joint space can be really picked up well on a Rosenberg view. And the last thing is a scanogram, which we'll be discussing about a bit later. So what is the importance of an obliquity of the X-ray? Now, normally, whenever you take an AP view, the central beam is actually placed about 1.5 centimeter below the apex of the patella. So just assume this is the apex of the patella and about approximately 1.5 centimeter below is where you put your central beam. Now, if obviously you don't get the ideal X-rays every time, and this is what happens when you don't get an ideal X-ray. So this is a patient. Both the patients are normal, but here you'll see that here the medial femoral-tibial space is very well visualized. The lateral is also very well visualized. In this patient, the lateral femoral-tibial space is good, but the medial femoral-tibial space is narrow. So this is how it is. So this is a nice big space, and this is where you'll see that someone may just reported that it's a moderate medial femoral-tibial joint space narrowing, right? Now, why this is happening? So, if you see here, the medial tibial plateau is in profile, whereas here I can actually appreciate the entire medial tibial plateau like this. So, because of the obliquity of the medial tibial plateau, you have a false appearance of the narrow joint space. So, whenever you see such radiographs with the obliquity, be sure before you report them as osteoarthrosis or a reduced joint space, because often it won't be. So, you can just take a clue. This is a very crude way, but this is your medial femur, and which is your anterior margin of the medial femur, and this is the anterior margin of the medial tibia. And this distance is actually maintained. So when you get such oblique X-rays, make sure that you have a look at them properly before you report a joint space narrow. What are the X-ray findings of osteoarthrosis? And you can remember them by the term loss. So, L stands for reduced joint space. Here you can see there is no obliquity and actually the joint space is very chinked. O is for osteophytes. So just remember, osteophytes does not mean that particular compartment has cartilage loss. The two don't go hand in hand. Here, this patient has medial femoral-tibial osteophytes, but this patient also has lateral femoral-tibial osteophytes. That does not mean that the patient has lateral femoral-tibial compartment cartilage loss. Subchondral sclerosis and subchondral cyst. Now, of these, loss of joint space is an indicator of some form of cartilage loss. And subchondral cyst is also an indicator of some form of cartilage loss because they usually develop after a cartilage wear has happened. So, osteophytes does not indicate cartilage loss in that particular compartment, whereas subchondral cyst and loss of joint space do indicate cartilage loss in that compartment. Now, whenever you get an X-ray, the first thing that should come to your mind is this a typical degenerative osteoarthrosis or is this an atypical osteoarthrosis which is developed because of some other reason? Now, it could be an early onset osteoarthrosis or anything of that sort. So, what are the things that should run in your mind whenever you see an X-ray? Is this a common age for OA? So, if I see a patient having OA in 60 plus, yes, this is a common age for OA. If I see an X-ray of a 30-year-old with OA, no, that's not a common age for OA. So your antenna should go up that why there is OA. Second, is this a common joint for OA? Now, normally, your hip and knee joints are your weight-bearing joints and they are commonly associated with OA. But if you get OA in a shoulder and an elbow joint, that's not common. They are not weight-bearing. So it is secondary to probably a rotator cuff tear in the shoulder or a posterolateral instability in the elbow. Again, for the knee, is this a common compartment to get OA? Now, normally, because our knee is the way our mechanical axis runs, our medial femoral-tibial compartment takes more load as compared to the lateral. And as a result, medial femoral-tibial compartment OAs happen in a primary degenerative OA. But if you get a primarily lateral compartment OA, then you need to think of some cause for it. And there are other features which go against a primary OA, like there are erosions, or if there is symmetrical tricompartmental joint space narrowing and no osteophytes, no subchondral cyst, then that is when you need to think of some other pathology. And other additional features which will be indicative of an early onset or a secondary OA, like signs of ligamentous insufficiency. So by now, you know the signs of ligamentous insufficiency. If you see a sulcus terminalis depression, if you see a Segonz fracture, and you see lateral compartment OA, you know that it is ACL insufficiency that is causing the lateral compartment OA. If you see healed lateral tibial plateau fractures, then obviously the articular surface is uneven, and such a patient will go into lateral compartment OA. So just whenever you get an X-ray, run these 5 points in your mind, and you will come to a conclusion whether it's a primary degenerative OA or whether it is an atypical OA. So here, 65-year-old female, knee pain on the medial aspect, looks like a primary OA to me. You have osteophytes, you have everything, and the age matches. The compartment matches, the joint matches. In this particular case, a 35-year-old male with knee pain and swelling. Now, if you see, first of all, 35 is a young age to develop OA. Second thing, this patient has a uniform joint space or a symmetric joint space narrowing involving medial and lateral femoral tibial compartments. Third thing to note is there is a lot of soft tissue density. So here you'll see there is a lot of soft tissue density. There is a large effusion. Okay, so there is a large density here as well. So this patient is probably having something else than just a primary OA. It's a secondary OA, which could be secondary to some inflammatory or infective pathology. Now, this was the MR of the patient, where you can see that medial compartment cartilage loss was there and the lateral compartment cartilage is intact. So again, what I told you before, presence of osteophytes does not mean that there is a cartilage loss in that particular compartment. This patient had lateral femoral osteophytes, but the lateral cartilage was good. So those two don't correlate. And here in this patient, you can see that there is diffuse narrowing. Okay, there is really no significant meniscus that's left, and there is a lot of synovial thickening. So this patient was actually an advanced inflammatory arthropathy with advanced secondary osteoarthrosis. 40-year-old female with knee pain laterally. So you can see that there is a lateral compartment OA, but the medial compartment is good. So this is obviously obliquity. Okay, here you can see that if I'll say this is my tibial plateau, but if I'll see the anterior margin of the tibia and the anterior margin of femur, the space is very good. Right? So this is a predominantly lateral compartment OA. Now, as I told you, lateral compartment OAs are not common because normally the weight bearing is the medial compartment. So when you get such X-rays, call up the patient and get some more information, get more history, because normally you don't get histories for X-rays and you just tend to report and send them off. You have to be a clinical radiologist. So call up these patients and get a good history. And what the patient gave the history was, there was a history of partial lateral meniscectomy. Okay, so what happens is, whenever there is a partial lateral meniscectomy, menisci act as shock absorbers for the cartilage. Once you remove the meniscus, there is increased chances of cartilage wear. And therefore, this patient, though she was young, she was only 40, she landed up into lateral compartment OA. So here you can see this was the MR of the patient. You can see that there is cartilage loss here, there is cartilage loss here. The medial compartment cartilage is good. You cannot see any lateral meniscus. You cannot see any lateral meniscus here also. And there is a cartilage loss. So, secondary to partial lateral meniscectomy, the patient had landed up into an early lateral compartment OA. So, what are the causes of isolated lateral compartment OA? ACL deficiency, lateral meniscectomy, prior trauma, that is Schatzkopf fracture or lateral tibial plateau fracture, which may cause irregularity of the articular surface and hence resultant OA. What are the causes of OA in a young patient? Post-infective, post-inflammatory, post-traumatic. Post-traumatic can again be any of these three, right? So whenever you get something out of the normal, just run those 5 points in your mind of age, joint, compartment, any other features that you're seeing which is against a primary OA, any features suggestive of a prior trauma. So just whenever you get something which doesn't fit into these five, your antenna should go up and you should start looking for the cause of OA. Now, what are the role of X-rays in the management of OA? So we've discussed about the diagnosis. Now, what about management? So joint space narrowing, particularly when it is in terms of management, you want a weight-bearing X-ray, and weight-bearing MRI is not possible. So obviously the information you get from a weight-bearing X-ray. So you can obviously subjectively classify the OA as mild, moderate, severe, depending upon the joint space narrowing. And second thing, the most important is to know the alignment of the knee, which is again not possible on an MRI because it is not a weight-bearing MRI. So you need weight-bearing scanograms for alignment of the knees. So this patient, again, this is a patient with very mild, see, there is no obliquity, but there is reduction in the joint space. There is a mild reduction in joint space. And if you see, there is tiny tibial intercondylar eminence osteophytes, tiny osteophyte here as well. So this was a patient with a mild or a early OA. This is a patient where there is moderate joint space narrowing, moderate osteophytes bilaterally, okay, meaning medial and lateral, and also added to that, you see subchondral sclerosis. And in this patient, besides all the findings, you also begin to see that there are subchondral cysts which have started to develop, right? So this was a very much advanced OA. Now, coming to scanogram. Scanogram is mainly done to evaluate the alignment, whether a patient has a valgus or a varus malalignment, or it's in neutral alignment. So varus is where the distal bone goes away from the midline. To be like in simple terms, it is nothing but bony, okay, where you get a bowing of the knees. Valgus is where the distal bone comes away from the midline. And again, in simple terms, it is nothing but a knock knee. So knock knee is valgus, bony is your varus. This is how you take three X-rays and then you stitch them together to get this X-ray. Now, key thing to remember, and this is very, very, very important, your patella should be facing forwards whenever you take an X-ray. You need to tell this to your technician, because if the patella is not facing forwards, you will not get the right values. A neutral alignment X-ray may appear like a malalignment and the patient will land up with a wrong surgery. Why wrong surgery? I'll let you know in the next few slides. So it is very important for the orthopod also that the patella are facing forwards. So this is a normal scanogram. Okay. Now, whenever you get a scanogram, what you need to understand is this is something called as the mechanical axis of the lower limb going from the center of the femoral head up to the center of the medial malleolus of the tibia. Okay. So this is your mechanical axis, and normally the mechanical axis passes just lateral to the tibial spine. Normally, an individual has a slightly valgus knee. Okay, so it passes just lateral to the tibial spine, which is called as the Milfillig's point. In this other leg, if you'll see, the mechanical axis has shifted medially. So this patient, this knee, the right knee is going into varus. Again, some more examples. This is bony. You can classically appreciate the bowing, and this is nothing but varus malalignment. Whereas in this patient, you can see there is a valgus malalignment. So normally, your line should have passed from here, just lateral to the tibial spine, but it is passing way too much lateral, and this is nothing but the valgus malalignment on a scanogram. There are some angles that you need to measure and put on the scanogram, but this is beyond today's session, so I'm not discussing them. You can read them up, so that's why I've just put it. You get it on Google, what is an LDFA and MPTA angle and how to measure them. And now this is what you need to understand about the scanogram, the management, and why scanogram or X-rays is important. So here you can see that if the patient has a tricompartmental OA, the patient will be going for a TKR. But what happens if the patient has only medial compartment OA on an X-ray? In such cases, patient goes for an MRI to assess the lateral and patellofemoral cartilage. If it is good, which means that patient has only unicompartment OA. Now, if the biological age, by biological age, obviously, I mean that if the patient is a runner, yet if the patient is 80 years old, but patient is a runner, then his biological age is less actually. So if the biological age is 55 to 60, then you do a scanogram. Okay, or less than 55, you do a scanogram to look for the alignment. If it's a neutral alignment and the ACL is intact, patient will go for a unicompartment replacement, which is nothing but the medial compartment replacement. But if the patient has a varus or a valgus malalignment, the patient will go for a HTO and DFO. So this is where we as radiologists play a role. This is where they get a scanogram done, and we need to inform the orthopods whether the patient has a malalignment or it's a neutral one. Whereas if the lateral or the patellofemoral compartment cartilage is bad, then the patient will land up into a TKR. So again, no more investigation. Such patients don't require a scanogram. But the gray zone is the biological age more than 60. Now, if the rest of the cartilage is good and the biological age is more than 60, some orthos prefer to do a unicompartment OA. Some orthos prefer to directly go for a total knee replacement. So, it's a gray zone whether you want to do a unicompartment replacement or a total knee replacement for a elderly patients with good lateral and patellofemoral cartilage. You don't have to remember this algorithm. The whole idea to show this algorithm was, you need to start thinking when you're reporting an X-ray that what all stuff you need to put in the report. So whenever you get a scanogram, what all stuff you need to put in the report, whether there is a malalignment, which compartment is involved. Similarly, on the knee X-ray, MC medial compartment OA is there, great. But you need to see if there is a lateral compartment OA. You need to see if there is a patellofemoral OA, because that's when your management plan will change. So this is just to make you understand that what stuff needs to be put in the report. So take home points, have a format to read any radiograph. Look at the review areas before reporting a radiograph as normal. So avoid satisfaction of search. In case of doubt, please call up the patient, call up the referring doctor and find out the clinical history. I'm telling you, your life will be very easy if you do that. Are the knee X-rays really useful? So by now, I hope you've understood that yes, knee X-rays are very useful in today's practice, even in today's practice when you have MRI. And that depends upon how well you understand these X-rays and how well you report them.